You're watching Tag TV.
Hello viewers, welcome to Newsweek South Asia, a program that talks about breeding of terrorism and its impact on South Asian nations. Let's begin with the headlines first. Another Pak-backed infiltration bid foiled as Indian security forces eliminate three terrorists in Kashmir. A baffled Pakistan blames India after New Zealand cricket team cancels its tour, citing security reasons. And gun-toting Taliban seek Afghanistan's United Nations seat. Pakistan has always treated Kashmir as a playground for its jihadist terror activities. Pakistan-backed terror groups, through regular infiltration, radicalization of local youth, killing innocent people, and several terror attacks, kept the situation tense in the Union Territory for several years. However, since the abrogation of Article 370, Indian security forces have managed to foil all its devious agendas and maintain tranquility in the valley. But Pakistan's unfulfilled dream of annexing Kashmir from India has resuscitated amid Taliban's takeover of Afghanistan, and now it is once again making attempts to hamper peace and accord in the region.
Jammu and Kashmir has remained at the target of Pakistan's state-sponsored terrorism since decades, be it deadly terror attacks, cross-border infiltration, or indulging into narco-terrorism. Islamabad has not deterred itself from indulging into anti-Indian activities. Recently, a major terror attack was foiled in Kashmir as Indian security personnel thwarted an infiltration bid and killed three terrorists in the Rampur sector near Uri town. According to sources, the terrorists had recently crossed over from Pakistan-occupied Kashmir into the Indian side. The identity of those terrorists shows that one among them is Pakistani. Details of other terrorists are yet to follow. Five AK-47s, eight pistols, and 70 hand grenades were recovered from the possession of the neutralized terrorists in the operation. Meanwhile, Indian security forces neutralized another terrorist in Shopian district of Jammu and Kashmir.
In the early hours of the morning, in Hatlanga forest, there is a movement observed for an infiltration bid. In a very short, brief operation, this attempt was eliminated by alert troops along the line of control. On 18th, a similar attempt was made in the hours of darkness, and over a period of about 3 days, during this operation, it was revealed, or rather confirmed, that attempt for infiltration was foiled. So in just last about 1 week's time, we have had one attempt which has been foiled and one that has been eliminated.
India's timely interventions on the border have left Pakistan deeply worried, as there has been a significant drop in the infiltration of terrorists from across the border due to the strict vigil of Indian security forces along the line of control. Thus, Pakistan is now preparing a devious recruitment plan in Jammu and Kashmir. The security forces in the country are on high alert amid Pakistan's plan to push Kashmiri youngsters into terrorism. Sources say that Pakistan-backed terror commanders in Kashmir are using Taliban's videos as part of its plan to radicalize youth and push them into their terror agenda. According to a report by Indian security agencies, 110 terrorists were eliminated in encounters till August this year. However, 82 youngsters from Kashmir have been brainwashed so far to join various terror organizations. Pakistan-based handlers look for cheaper assets among local youth that can be used to carry out killings of soft targets without any fear of being able to reveal the larger designs of their handlers.
It is a fact that Pakistan-based terrorists, Lakshya Toiba,
हिजबुल मुजाहिदीन जैश मोहम्मद आईएसआईएस तालिबान विद द असिस्टेंस ऑफ द पाकिस्तानी आर्मी एंड द आईएसआई आर मेकिंग इंक्रीजिंग अटेम्प्ट्स एट इन्फिल्ट्रेशन इनटू जम्मू एंड कश्मीर सो दैट दे कैन कॉज मैक्सिमम क्योस एंड मेहम दे वॉन्ट टू डिस्टर्ब पीस एंड ट्रैंक्विलिटी इन द वैली सीज फायर नॉट विद स्टैंडिंग द एफर्ट्स आर ऑन गोइंग एंड विल कंटिन्यू टू इंक्रीज बाई द ऑर्डर ऑफ मैग्नीट्यूड इन द वीक्स एंड मंथ्स अहेड.
Failing to create unrest through traditional methods, well-known terror groups are now adopting new terror techniques. Pakistan-based handlers of proscribed terror outfit Lashkar-e-Taiba has been using the pseudo-acronym the Resistance Force to take responsibility for the terror strikes in Jammu and Kashmir aimed at maintaining plausible deniability and evading law enforcement agencies. The resistance front, which is backed by Pakistani handlers, is an offshoot of the LET, and it has taken the responsibility for various terrorist activities in Jammu and Kashmir in the recent past. Run by local terrorists, TRF is a face-saving wing of the outlaw terror organizations being named in terrorist acts. Unlike the Fidayeen attacks and other armed strikes on the security forces by traditional terror groups like Lashkar, Jaish and Hizbul Mujahideen, TRF has concentrated mainly on soft targets like local party leaders and businessmen, apparently to generate a wave of fear among civilians after the abrogation of Article 370 in 2019. For decades, Pakistan has been dreaming of capturing Kashmir, yet it has never been able to do so. It is again dreaming the same, this time with the help of the Taliban. Consequently, Jammu and Kashmir has witnessed a slight rise in violence. Terror launch pads close to the border are being active again, with Pakistan-backed terror groups and their associates continuously attempting to foment trouble in the Union Territory by making constant infiltration attempts despite ceasefire in place.
In 2009, Sri Lankan cricketers were attacked in Lahore. Since then, most international teams have refused to tour the South Asian country, leaving Pakistan to play nearly all their home games in the United Arab Emirates. Recently, New Zealand and England cricket teams cancelled their Pakistan tour over security threat. Outraged by such decisions, Pakistani cricket lovers and their frustrated politicians are now blaming India for it.
New Zealand recently dropped a bombshell by deciding to abort its cricket tour of Pakistan even before the first ball was bowled. In the summer of 2002, New Zealand abruptly flew out of Pakistan after a bomb blast left several dead near the hotel where the visiting team was staying in Karachi. It took them more than 18 years to return to Pakistan. However, this time there was no untoward incident but an undisclosed security threat, which was enough for them to cancel the tour. The New Zealand team was staying at the Serena Hotel, which is merely 3 kilometers away from Lal Masjid, where the Taliban flags were hoisted recently. Cricket-hungry Pakistan got a further jolt as after New Zealand, England also decided to scrap the tour of the strife-torn country.
ये खिलाड़ी हैं, जंग करने नहीं जा रहे. जब आप कह रहे हो कि कोई खतरा नहीं तो इतनी सिक्योरिटी दे रहे हैं ना आप, इसका मतलब खतरा है तो इतनी सिक्योरिटी दे रहे हैं ना. खतरा तो मैं आगे बता रहा हूँ कि मेन खतरा क्या है, लेकिन ये सिक्योरिटी जो आप इतनी भारी भरकम दे रहे हैं तो इसके बाद खिलाड़ी खेलेगा कैसे इतनी टेंशन में. जब बस में बैठ के वो होटल से निकल के मैच की तरफ जा रहा होगा और उसको चारों तरफ पुलिस और फौज की गाड़ियां, ऊपर हेलीकॉप्टर, स्कूटरें, फिर ग्राउंड में जब वो दाखिल होता है पवेलियन से देखता है कि पिच पे बम ढूंढे जा रहे हैं, पूरे ग्राउंड में बम ढूंढे जा रहे हैं, स्ट्रेस तो होगी ना.
Former Pakistan pace bowler Shoaib Akhtar says New Zealand pulling out of the tour just before the toss is a body blow to cricket in Pakistan. His tweet, "New Zealand just killed Pakistan cricket," shows nothing but his ignorance. Can the New Zealand be faulted? The attacks on Sri Lankan cricketers are still fresh in the minds of the cricket-playing world. The safety of touring cricket teams in Pakistan had come under extreme criticism and invited outrage from cricketing boards all over the world when the Sri Lankan cricket team was attacked in 2009. The attack was believed to have been carried out by Lashkar-e-Jhangvi that wounded six members of the Sri Lankan national team. Six Pakistani policemen and two civilians were also killed in the attack. Now it is for Shoaib Akhtar to realize if New Zealand killed Pakistan cricket or Pakistan's ISI in bed with terrorists from Haqqani Network in Afghanistan to Hafiz Saeed and Masood Azhar in Lahore and Bahawalpur. Why would Jacinda Ardern, Prime Minister of New Zealand, want to risk her cricketers when the writ of the UN-designated global terrorist like Hafiz Saeed runs large across Pakistan? However, as part of their baseless propaganda, Pakistan is now claiming that the threat to New Zealand came in an email that originated in India.
A fake ID of Hamza Afridi was used. Hamza Afridi 7899@gmail.com was used to send a threat to New Zealand team, but actually this threat was sent from Mumbai, Maharashtra.
New Zealand calling off the series in Pakistan is a tight slap across the face of those who have used terror as an instrument of state policy. It may be seen as a death of cricket in Pakistan, but it is a wake-up call for the people of Pakistan. Those celebrating the return of the Taliban in Afghanistan and the support given by the Pakistan Army and Deep State are playing with fire, a dangerous fire that threatens not just any single entity, but burn Pakistan down.
Taliban, who have overrun Afghanistan and disenfranchised half of its population, are seeking to represent Kabul at the United Nations. The outrageous bid for Kabul's UN seat by the Taliban, which has proscribed terrorists in its leadership ranks, came after the group nominated Sohail Shaheen as Afghanistan's so-called new ambassador to the United Nations. A report.
As world leaders discuss the future of Afghanistan at the United Nations General Assembly this week, the group that currently holds power in Kabul is conspicuously absent. The Taliban wants to change that, despite concerns from the United States and others. Barely a month after Taliban took over Afghanistan's capital city, Kabul, the group has written to the United Nations seeking a seat at the General Assembly. The Taliban wants its envoy to address the annual United Nations General Assembly's high-level meeting of world leaders, and the group has nominated their Doha-based spokesperson Sohail Shaheen as Afghanistan's so-called representative. Currently, the UN ambassador representing Afghanistan, Ghulam Isakzai, is scheduled to address the final day of the General Assembly. The Taliban has said it wants international recognition and financial help to rebuild the war-battered country, but the makeup of the new Taliban government poses a dilemma for the UN. Several of the interim ministers are on the UN's blacklist of international terrorists and funders of terrorism.
Currently, the Taliban represents a government that is not at all inclusive. There are many ethnicities, there are many communities, there are many political factions that have been kept out. And until such a time, the government in Kabul becomes more and more inclusive, I don't think there is any chance of the world community recognizing the Taliban so that they can come and take Kabul seat at the United Nations. One or two countries or three or four countries may recognize the Taliban, possibly Pakistan, possibly Qatar, possibly China. But broad-based recognition enabling Taliban to take Afghanistan's seat at the United Nations at this point in time looks very unlikely to me.
No country in this world has so far recognized the sketchy administration in Kabul, whose representatives openly carry heavy automatic weapons into office. The response on social media to the Taliban's request was quick and cutting. If they want representation at the UN, they should try sending a woman. The Taliban has virtually disenfranchised women in Afghanistan by resorting to medieval practices, curtailing, among other things, like free movement and employment. Some Afghan girls have returned to their primary schools with gender-segregated classes, but older girls have faced an anxious wait with no clarity over if and when they would be able to resume their studies.
مکتبای پسران باز شده ولی از دخترها باز نشدن به خاطر که اینا میگن که شما اینا میگن که دخترها حق اجازه ندارن که درس بخونن در حالی که دختران امروز دختران 25 سال پیش نیستن دختران از 25 سال پیش تا امروز تحولات و پیشرفت‌های چشمگیری داشتن بنابراین ما هدف ما این هست که مکتبا شروع بشه چرا که ما هدف‌های زیادی داریم ما 10 سال زحمت کشیدیم درس خواندیم و دوست داریم که دوباره ادامه تحصیل بدیم و دوباره تحصیلات ختمه
When the Taliban ruled Afghanistan during 1996 to 2001, they lacked international support. Only three countries recognized them, two of them, Saudi Arabia and the UAE, later withdrew their recognition over the Taliban's patronage of Al-Qaeda. Only Taliban's friend philosopher and guide Pakistan continued to back their regime. Once again, Taliban are making moves to get international recognition and Pakistan is making every possible endeavor to mainstream their terror group. Recently, the SAARC meeting was also cancelled when Islamabad insisted that Taliban be allowed to send its representative to the summit.
To gain some legitimacy for the Taliban in some grouping or the other, as a pathway to getting more broad-based recognition, so that they are recognized as the regime in Afghanistan. So these games from Afghanistan on the part of Pakistan on behalf of the Taliban, they will occur. As to how far they will be successful, I think that depends on how representative Taliban makes itself. In the current form, this government does not get international recognition. The form in which it will get international recognition means that Pakistan's influence will come to an end.
Recognition brings governments a lot of international legal benefits that includes diplomatic immunities, for example, which means Taliban leaders can travel to outside the country without the risk of getting arrested. There are other benefits too, like if the US recognizes the Taliban, they can eventually get access to Afghanistan's assets in the United States. Until there is clarity within the international community on the recognition of the government, common Afghans are caught in the middle of the debate.
India is the victim of terrorism emanating from neighboring Pakistan. On various international platforms, New Delhi has not only raised a strong voice against terrorism, which is affecting the whole South Asian region and Western world too, but also played an important role in forming the counter-terrorism strategies. We have a report.
India has been a constant victim of terrorism. However, with its revived counter-terrorism strategies, the country has not only managed to defeat this menace at home, but is also leading the collective fight against this global threat along with the world's powerful economies like the United States. India is not only concerned about safety and security of people living in its own territory, but it always reiterates adopting and executing improved strategies to counter terrorism globally, especially in South Asia. Recently, India's permanent representative to the UN, T.S. Tirumurthy, reiterated that India has always played a significant role in shaping global counter-terrorism strategy and will continue to do so in future.
As regards terrorism, you know that India has always been at the forefront to push for a joint and collective effort to combat terrorism in all its forms and manifestations. And we have played an active role in shaping the global counter-terrorism strategy.
Meanwhile, the current situation in Afghanistan has become a serious challenge for the whole world in fight against terrorism.
Last month, the Taliban seized power in Afghanistan after the US-backed Afghan government collapsed and President Ghani fled the country. With the declaration of new Taliban regime, Afghanistan is slowly becoming a country where there is no food, but guns are in abundance. There is a deep concern about Afghanistan's future and the safety and security of neighboring countries.
Our Prime Minister has already made our stand very clear in his recent address to the SCO summit last week. And in his statement, the Prime Minister dealt with some very specific issues relating to non-inclusive, non-negotiated transition of power. He emphasized the need for representation of all sections, including women and minorities, the impact of fundamentalism and instability on terrorism and extremist ideologies, increasing radicalization, the impact of uncontrolled flow of drugs, illegal weapons, and human trafficking, and the serious humanitarian crisis facing Afghanistan.
For several years, India has been itself battling terrorism with great determination, and it keeps raising its voice against this menace at the international level. During recent visit of Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi to the United States too, terrorism remained the main agenda where he addressed the UN General Assembly as well as attended the Quad Summit. Meanwhile, Modi also had a formal meeting with the Vice President of the United States, Kamala Harris, during which Harris Suomoto referred to Pakistan's role in terrorism. Harris called upon Pakistan to act against terrorist groups operating from its soil to ensure they do not threaten the security of both the United States and India.
When the issue of terrorism came up, the Vice President Suomoto referred to Pakistan's role in that regard. She said that there were terror groups that were working there. She asked Pakistan to take action so that these groups do not impact on US security and that of India. She agreed with the Prime Minister's briefing on the fact of cross-border terrorism and the fact that India had been a victim of terrorism for several decades now, and all the need to rein in and closely monitor Pakistan's support for such terrorist groups.
Moreover, India's month-long presidency of the powerful United Nations Security Council ended last month on August 31 with substantive outcomes on key global issues, including terrorism. And as per T.S. Tirumurthy, India will stop all attempts to weaken the collective resolve of the member states to fight terrorism or to provide justification for terror. And with that, we come to the end of this edition of Newsweek South Asia. We will be back next week with more news, views and analysis from the subcontinent. Meanwhile, do keep writing to us at nwsa@nin.com. This is Shreya Savajay, signing off on the behalf of entire production team of Newsweek South Asia. Goodbye and take care.
Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.